In all seriousness, Jeremy, thank you, man. This has been, I don't know, at least for me, this has been really, really good stuff. Very practical. This last session was just so good. I'm really thankful. The feeling that I keep getting, and I've had this, you know, experience that I've had with from getting to know you, is that this is such a breath of fresh air for me. You know, that it, like the last session is so concrete and so practical and takes the Bible and brings it down to a level where I can actually, you know, answer the detailed things of life and help other people do that as well. And so it's just such a breath of fresh air taking these abstract ideas and thoughts and, you know, doctrines that we know about the Word of God and then breaking them down into such a point where we're actually, you know, doing real ministry. And it's very refreshing. It's a breath of fresh air for me. And so I'm thankful. I got a few things written down. If we have time, maybe we'll take some few questions from the end. But what I'd like to do is kind of walk through a counseling scenario and then ask a few questions. And I won't let you ramble because I don't want to take, I got a few other things I want to talk about too.
Okay.
But the first thing I think that we run into when we counsel people is this idea of, you know, how do we treat somebody? How do you go about, because there's people who you might talk to that are unbelievers. So the idea of how do you counsel somebody who says, no, I'm not a Christian, or do you even do that? Or you just say, hey, why don't you turn on Oprah? I don't know. Or Dr. Phil.
We're not going to say that last one, no. We're definitely not going to Oprah.
So how do you handle somebody who is, you know, comes into your office or you meet somebody at Hy-Vee and flat out they're just, you know, maybe they even think they're a Christian, you know? Okay.
Good question. Okay, if you guys could open up to Ephesians 2, I'll try to be quick with this. The short answer is we can't really counsel unbelievers. Now, I can, as a way of maybe giving them a helpful tool, give them a tool or two at the fruit level of trying to, you know, if somebody's, you know, getting drunk and beating his wife all the time, and, you know, I might say, you know, I might want to lay off the sauce, but in actual counseling and meeting with someone, you really can't counsel them. And the reason for that is, apart from the gospel of Jesus Christ, I have no hope for you. And quite literally, an unbeliever, apart from the gospel of Jesus Christ, has no hope. Listen to the language of Ephesians 2. 1, you were dead in your trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work, and the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. And then you jump down to chapter 3. Or is it chapter 2 at the end? Hold on. No, it's chapter 2. Therefore, verse 11, remember that at one time you were Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made by the flesh with hands. Remember that you were at that time, so here is their state as unbelievers, separate from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. The problem with trying to counsel, in any in-depth counsel with someone who says, I don't want your Jesus, I don't want your Bible, but I'm having a terrible marriage, can you help? Is what they're saying is, can you give me some other hope other than the gospel? And if I say, sure, I can help your marriage get better. I can help your with your anxiety. I'm putting up a competing hope. I'm putting up a competing gospel. And there is no hope apart from Jesus Christ. And the promises of God only apply to believers. And so, yes, and simply put, I can certainly empathize and step into someone's suffering. I can certainly show that I care and build a relationship. But I frequently find that as people are dealing with the effects of the curse and the fall, it's actually a great inroad for evangelism, because the hardest people I find to reach are content, complacent people. People that are recognizing their brokenness are a lot easier to say, hey, we got a cure, we got medicine, because what usually offends people with the gospel is, I'm not sick. But somebody who's coming for counsel is recognizing, at least in some area, I'm broken. In some area, I'm not well. And so I find it's very easy to go to the gospel with that quickly.
Amen. Good word, thank you. Good answer. The other scenario, and I'm going to step through a couple different, you know, elements, and because the reality is, in my experience, is hardly, I wouldn't say hardly, but many times things don't go as you hope, you know, in a counseling situation.
Yes, yes.
You know, not everybody's, oh, it's going well, and here's specifically what I've done, and I'm reading my Bible verses in the bathroom, and it takes me a half hour, and I'm, and so, anyways, the reality is a couple things. How do you go about dealing in a, you know, you talked about helping people in a loving way, not just dropping the truth bomb on them.
Right.
You know, people tend to be, this, and I hate to put people in categories, people are gentle, you know, they're grace people,
yep.
And they tend to fear men,
yep.
And so they tend to be really loving, but there's also the truth person that struggles, yep. with grace.
Mm-hmm.
If you're in one of those two categories, I mean, speak to, for me, I'm a grace guy. It's hard for me to say hard things to people.
Right.
How can you help me practically? Do you have any advice on how I can go about becoming more of a truth person and for a truth person be more graceful?
Sure. I totally get what you're saying. I come from the truth side. So let's start with that. The passage that, I'll just give you one passage. I don't really do the life verse, but if I had a life verse, that 2 Timothy 2:24 to 26 would be it. And there's a lot tied up there, but I'll just reference it. The Lord's slave must not be quarrelsome, but kind to all, able to teach, patient when wronged, with gentleness, correcting those who are in opposition. If perhaps God will grant them repentance, leading to the knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will. Well, there's a lot going on there. Is this person who's wrong, this person who I need to speak a word to, is really, and I'm going to generate sympathy for them, like an animal caught in a snare. And in my experience, and what I've seen, actually I have no experience letting animals loose from a snare, but in what I've seen on the Nature Channel, when you go to an animal, has anyone here actually let an animal out of a snare before? Brett has. Do they, like, are they really happy when they see you coming? They're like, yes, you're going to let me out of this snare. What do, Brett? They claw and bite and kick because they're scared and they're trapped. And that explains why you got to be willing to be suffer mistreatment, because when people are snared in a trial, they're going to bite and kick. And it doesn't make the biting more less painful, but it certainly, I get it. I understand it. It helps me be sympathetic. But the part that gets me with that is, if perhaps God will grant them repentance to the knowledge of the truth, and what my mind will say to me and used to say to me a lot is, I'll say to you this week, once you learn this, you can't unlearn it. So let's be good, Jason. Is, so you're looking, you got to go talk to Brett. And Brett's going to tear, you think Brett's going to tear your head off if you go talk to him, so you don't want to talk to him. If an angel of the Lord appeared to you and said, Jason, if you go talk to Brett, I just want to let you know the Lord's going to grant repentance, and he's going to repent, and he's going to thank you. He will just be so thankful. Would you hesitate to go talk to him? Of course you wouldn't. If you knew that if you shared your faith with a coworker, that God was going to open their eyes to see what you're saying, you'd be excited to share it with you. The fear, the hesitation comes from me second-guessing what I think God's likely to do, which I don't think is a very worthwhile or healthy endeavor. Sitting back, I don't think it's likely God's going to grant repentance to that person. Oh, no. No, that whole verse takes that out of my hands, and it takes it even out of their hands. I can't even say, they're not going to listen to me. Well, they will if God grants repentance, right? So my marching orders don't change, regardless of whether they listen or not. I got to be patient. I got to be gentle. I got to be kind. I got to be able to teach. I got to be willing to be wrong, and I got to go talk to them. And when I sort of work through that in my head, it removes the excuses. No, if I knew they'd listen, I'd go. Okay, then, so how confident are you know what God's going to do? Not very. So will you be obedient? Yeah, I guess I'll be obedient. Yeah, and then you go. That Jonah, for me, has been helpful. Yeah. On the other side with the grace, I remember when I was in college, we had counseling projects, and I was working with one of my professors, and he noticed that I was a truth guy. A lot of it came from getting saved later in life. I got saved when I was 23. Yeah, 23. And so I was all like, truth, here's truth, you know, and sort of dropping truth bombs left, right, and center. And I remember him asking me once, he said, you know, he went to the passage in John where Jesus says to his disciples, I have much more to say to you, and you can't bear it right now. And he said, Jeremy, you want to be like Jesus, don't you? I said, yeah. He said, how often, if ever, has that thought crossed your mind? Because I'm the type of guy who, like, I'm making a point, and like you're like, huh? Oh, now's the time to dump. Like, once they don't have a response anymore, now's the, and 15 more reasons why I'm right, you know. And I have much more to say, and you cannot bear it right now. You know. And so those types of things, and the method, in fact, the verse he used as sort of our our theme verse for the counseling time was like an apple of gold in settings of silver is a fitly word well spoken. And what the passage references in Proverbs is that what's important is both the content and the delivery. Or you can go to 1 Corinthians 13. If I have all wisdom and don't have love, I'm like a clanging gong. And so what he said to me is, Jeremy, frequently you've got good content, you've got apples of gold, but rather serving it on settings or trays of silver, you're bringing it on like dirty clay trays, like apples of gold and like, you know, an unwashed clay plate. And those types of things were helpful in thinking through those things in 1 Corinthians 13 or even James 4, you know, the wisdom from above is first gentle and then peaceable and open to reason and kind and full of good fruits. And it's tempting for me to say, but I'm right. Well, okay, you know, you can be dead right. So those are my tips on both sides.
And I think you end up, you know, you go to help sanctify somebody else, you end up getting sanctified in this process as well.
Yeah, the Lord's a multitasker.
It is.
The Lord is a multitasker.
He's very good at that. I had this written down, and somebody had mentioned it too, at the break. But so you're counseling somebody, somebody you love dearly, and maybe it's, you know, maybe it's not even, maybe it is a big issue, maybe it isn't. We'll talk about that next, maybe. But they reject you. We kind of hit on this a little bit last night. What should our response be as Christians when the person is pretty obviously probably a believer and they just reject it? What practical advice do you, I know prayer, but I mean, how do we handle that? I suppose, you know, probably this gets into an issue of my next question kind of off that, and maybe you just want to run with this, is, you know, you gave the example of a mom worshiping her child. That's probably not a church discipline issue. So if you confront somebody in that and say, hey, you need to do this, and they reject you, that's probably not something you're going to bring them for the church and put their picture up there and say, reject this person when you see them in public, and versus something that's more serious like adultery and they run from it. Right. So walk us through, you know.
I want to be careful here because I don't want to make a list of venial and mortal sins. No, but the temptation is we got big sins, we got little sins.
Yeah.
Big sins. But what's often funny is our big sins aren't the ones God lists as a big thing. You know, seven things the Lord finds detestable and eight are an abomination to him, and then he's like a proud heart. Mm-hmm. Pride doesn't usually make our list of big sins. Makes God's list of big sins, but not generally. I don't know the last time I saw a million man march against pride, but, you know, we're very selective. We're respecters of sins. I would think it's not the issue of big sin, small sin, but concrete sin versus unconcrete. I'm not going to church discipline someone over the motives and the attitudes of their heart. I'm gonna deal with what's concrete. So a mother idolizing her child, no. I'll talk to her, I'll try to, you know, plead to their instructor. A mother acting upon that idolization and bearing bad fruit, that you can deal with. Yeah. That you can deal with. You are failing to love your husband. I've seen wives completely disregard their husbands because they know it's best for their kids, and just their world centers around that. They're not doing what they should do as a wife. They're not doing what they should do as a woman in Christ. They're neglecting other responsibilities. All you can deal with those things. And those things, if there's a lack of repentance, you could, if necessary, press through to church discipline. This is a woman who is not honoring her husband. She is not being a good wife to him because she's just worshiping her child and building her life around that. That's something I'd go after, potentially. Yeah. It's the concrete manifestations. You're dealing with church discipline. If you're brother sins, we're at the fruit level. Now, it all comes from the heart, but what we can deal with concretely is the fruit level of things. You're not going to church discipline someone for being proud. You may go after the evidences of pride, the way that they act upon that. So I don't want to separate it from big, small sins. It's concrete sin, and the attitudes of the heart is how I would separate that personally.
So if somebody rejects, you know, let's say it's a close personal relative, and whatever the sin issue is, I mean, maybe they are not in your church. I mean, how do you handle just somebody's hardened heart?
You pray. You keep looking back to 2 Timothy 2:24. You're not quarrelsome. I mean, if you're dealing with a local church, you have an authority structure and you have a body life that you can then go and bring two or three. I mean, let's start with the local church and move outside of it. So there's two things. I want to separate. The Bible speaks to some things in command, some things in precept, and some things in principle and wisdom. And you got to know what you're dealing with. Some things are black and white. What you're doing, Scripture forbids. Or you're failing to do something Scripture commands. That is something that I would, if we can't get on the same page, I'd bring in another brother or sister or two to try to talk to you because we have to resolve this because I'm convinced you're sinning. Other things are principle. They're strongly attested to principles, but they're not as clear-cut as commands in that sense. Principles of priority of things and where things go. And then you're out to wisdom, and so you can talk to them. I think this is really a bad idea. I'll give you an example. Is there a law for, what are the laws around marriage? Biblically, there's not a ton of laws about who to marry. Don't marry someone of the same gender, right? Don't marry someone else's husband or wife. Don't marry a really close relative. Don't marry an unbeliever. Missing any? I mean, that's pretty much it, right? Does the Bible have precepts and principles? There's a bunch more that go on there. If you're a wife, if you're a woman, you want to marry a man who can demonstrate he can lead you and demonstrate he can shepherd you. Because according to Ephesians 5, that's the primary role of a husband, is to love his wife as Christ loved the church and wash her with the water of the word. This guy is not showing himself able to do that. He is not showing himself able to minister the word to this woman. I think it's a really bad idea for them to get married. Would I church discipline that marriage? Of course not. It's not a violation of a clear command. It's a violation of a huge principle. I would advise against it. I wouldn't perform the marriage if I thought it was a really bad idea. But I couldn't charge them with sin. But basically what I'd be saying to the couple is, you, when you become this woman's husband, you're going to be tasked with ministering her the word and cleansing her. And you have no interest and no ability to do that. So you're going to fail. You're going to get married and you're just going to fail because you can't do this. Why do you want this guy to lead you when he's not leading you biblically? But those are principles. That's not law. But that's, I'm going to Ephesians 5. Here's what a husband's supposed to do. Here's what a wife's supposed to do. And maybe the woman has no interest in his leadership and she doesn't like his advice and doesn't like his opinions. And it's like, you're supposed to, when you get married, you're going to have to submit to this guy. And you think he's an idiot. You know, I've never met the couple that's doing this, but you know, that's not law. Like, I wouldn't church discipline that. I wouldn't pursue it. I would advise strongly against it. Everything I see in principles and patterns in Scripture, I think this is a bad idea. But I got to be able to separate those two things from law and principle and wisdom.
So somebody outside the church you don't know, somebody you love, is doing something that's obviously wrong, and they reject your counsel, they reject you, they've hardened their heart.
Then if they're a professing believer, this is tough. This is really tough when you don't have a local body. But there are principles that go beyond even Matthew 18. If you open your Bible to 2 Thessalonians, the last chapter of 2 Thessalonians. And I've had to go through something like this with a family member for a while who is a professing believer and not being obedient and knew that they're... And this gets back to teaching. Sometimes people, the issue is really teaching. They don't think what they're doing is wrong. And so they think what they're doing is okay. And now what I need to do is try to find a way to teach them. I need to try to find a way to minister the word to them. Other times you're dealing with someone, I know what's wrong, I don't care. That's a very different thing than, I don't see what's wrong with this. But assuming you're dealing with the, I don't care, I know what's wrong, or God will have to forgive me or something. I'm doing this. Assuming you're dealing with that, there is a general principle, and how this plays out is tough, but 2 Thessalonians 3:14. If anyone does not obey what we say in this letter, take note of that person, have nothing to do with them so that they may be ashamed. Do not regard him as an enemy, but warn him as a brother. At a certain point, if I'm dealing with someone who's professing to be a Christian, insisting they're a Christian, I'm going to have a conversation with them where they've rejected what I'm saying and they don't care. I'm going to say, look, I love you. You say you're a Christian. Do you want me to treat you like one? Really, you mean that? Because some people just say they're Christian. What they basically mean is I'm moral. All right, so it's not just a term. They say they're a Christian, but they're really claiming. You're claiming to be a person trusting the gospel of Jesus Christ. Okay, then if we can't talk about this thing in your life, we don't have a whole lot else to talk about. It's so important. I'm so concerned for your soul that if what you're saying to me is I don't want to talk about this anymore, I'm living with my boyfriend, I don't care, then we don't have a whole lot else to talk about because I love you too much to sideline that. If you thought somebody had cancer and you thought it was treatable, but they had all the symptoms for cancer and you're like, you need to go get checked out. And I don't want to go get checked out. Stop talking about it. At what point, if you loved them, would you stop exhorting them while there's a cure, while it's treatable, to go get checked out? I see someone doing something destructive and ultimately maybe deadly. I'm not going to be able to let it go if I love them. And it's not judgment. I'm not hating them, But in a general principle, if you're insisting you're a Christian, even though we aren't part of the same church and there is no church discipline, there's still a principle of I can't just sort of hang up, pretend everything is okay, and ultimately salve your conscience. I can't just sort of, okay, we'll set that aside and we'll just watch some football and hang out and chew the fat and talk politics. You're dying in front of me. You're self-destructing in front of me. I love you. I got to talk about this. Mm. You know, is that?
Yeah, that's really good. And I guess all these, a lot of this, you know, brings me to this kind of point, and I know you've faced this. A lot of this talk that we've had is so foreign to Christian culture and to the local Christian church. Now, I know a lot of the churches in Engage Network, you know, we have biblical counselors on staff and those sorts of things, so maybe not here, but probably in my, you start talking this way, don't talk to somebody who's, I mean, this is so foreign to our Christian culture, at least in America, and but I see it being so vitally important. I mean, how do you deal with just the shock factor of what you're saying? And then also, how important is this to you, do you think, to have this as a biblical counseling as a ministry in the local church? And I know that's a big question, but you got five minutes.
Let me deal with the first part. The first part is I just tell people to think through it and not make it law. Part of the, it's not, it, see, if you work through it progressively, it makes sense. Like even Matthew 18. I helped somebody church discipline me once without them realizing that's what I was doing. They thought I'd sinned in some area. I didn't think what I did was sinful. And we got together and talked. And I said, okay, help me understand where you think I was wrong here. And they told me again, I don't think what I did was wrong. And this guy was still bothered by it. And I said, okay, I really think what would be helpful for us right now would be, since we're at loggerheads and yet we're to be at peace, would be for us to find two or three people that we respect their opinion, we think are wise and have the spirit, we bring them in and see what they say. Now, to me, that's just so intuitive. It's not, we got to go to step two. It's, we're brothers in the Lord and we're not at peace. You think I'm sinning. I don't think I am, but as Paul says, just because my conscience is leaving me alone doesn't mean I'm innocent. I could be deceived. So we must call in some wise counsel to see what they think. So it's not, here's this law and here's this mean thing called church discipline. I mean, he didn't realize that's what I was, I'm like, basically, I'm going to help you step to me. You know, now in the end, the council agreed with me that no, Jeremy hadn't done anything. You know, I was vindicated in that sense, but it made all the sense in the world to me. Yeah. So if you help people see the organic nature of some of these things and not simply, okay, it was time for the shunning, you know, then I think that helped. No, because that's the problem. Notice that passage in Thessalonians. Do not regard them as an enemy, but warn them as a brother. This is something you're doing lovingly. This isn't like, okay, it's time to cut ties. No, it's the approach of, I love you so much, I can't, like my heart's breaking here. I can't just play a game of Scrabble with you while you're dying in front of me. You know, like tell me you're not a Christian. Tell me you're not trusting in Jesus Christ. And I'll be happy to love you and look for opportunities to witness you. But while you're telling me you're his and you love him and you're serving, you want to serve and obey him and you're doing this, I can't not talk about it. Mm. And that's much more organic and natural than you are forbidden from talking to, I'm sorry, I keep putting a Southern accent on when I try to make the laws. My wife says it's a bad thing.
It's kind of cool.
I don't know why, but it's very different than just saying, Jason, you're forbidden from talking to that person.
Yeah.
And that's going to move towards more of the judgmental, looking down your nose. You know, I'm not doing this because I'm a good person, you're a bad person. I'm doing this because I need to help you wake up to the seriousness of what you're doing. One more thing on this. If we don't do this, we will eventually tolerate sin and deal with sin as not urgent. And if I read my New Testament rightly, unrepentant sin, not the sin we all struggle with, but the sin that's hard-hearted, the raised fist at God, the no, is urgent. You read Hebrews, that stuff is urgent. And if we tolerate it because we're unwilling to go to that final point, we're inevitably going to communicate it's not urgent. And Paul warns of a little leaven leavening the whole loaf. And people in the body will see people in sin and doing things they shouldn't be doing and nothing happening. They're going to conclude, well, this is not that big of a deal. You know, and they're gonna go on and do it too, and so for the person and for the purity of the body, we've got to not arrogantly because they're the bad people and we're the good people, but lovingly because this stuff is urgent and important and crucial. We got to love them enough to not desist in warning and calling them to trust Christ.
Amen. Back to the local church, real quick, as we wrap up.
Okay.
How important, I mean, I know I've talked to people already, you know, they're ready set fire, you know. So, you know, how important do you think it is to have lay people who understand the importance of biblical counseling or are trained in it, to have this as a ministry in your local church? Is it an option even? Or, I mean, what are you doing
in your church? It is crucial. Okay, Ephesians 5. Go to Ephesians. It's either 4 or 5. We're talking about church growth. And how does the church grow? Counseling is not something for professionals. Counseling is not even something for church leaders. Counseling is something Christians do. Hmm. We all counsel. And we can go to Romans 15:14, where Paul says you're competent to counsel each other or admonish. It's the word noutheteo, where nouthetic counseling comes from. But in Ephesians 4, this passage gets me excited about how Christ is going to build his church. And I want you to notice how it's done. Okay, so Ephesians 4:11, and he gave the apostles and the prophets and the evangelists and the shepherds and the teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. Let's pause there. The leadership of the church is not there to do the work of the ministry. The leadership of the church is there to equip the saints to do the work of the ministry. The work of the ministry rightly belongs to Christians, not Christian leaders, first off. Christian leadership is there to model and equip and encourage. So I have the work of the ministry in so much as I'm a Christian, not because I'm a pastor. By virtue of being a Christian, I have ministry to do. As a leader, I have an equipping function, I have an encouraging function, I have a modeling function, but the work of the ministry is for the saints, to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ, so that ministry is bodybuilding. Until we all attain to the unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to the mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemings. Okay, that's how it's not to be done. There's your put off. Okay, how does the body get built? But rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. How does the body build itself up in love? It's a ministry of words, of people speaking the truth in love to each other. What people? Just some people? No. Every joint, every part working properly, when that's happening, it makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. How important is counseling? The entire growth of the church depends upon it.
Wow. That's a great place to end. Jeremy, thanks again, brother. I appreciate your wisdom and the way God has blessed you. And we want to pray for a blessing upon your ministry down in Martinsdale. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time. It has been fruitful. It has been encouraging. It has been convicting. Father, let us, as we learned, not just to take the conviction that maybe is going on in our hearts right now, whether it's on a sin issue in our life or just something you're calling us to, let us renew our mind and then put on the new self and to be into action, work into action, and to hold ourselves and accountable and to those around us. And Father, I thank you for your word. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, dying on a cross, raising again, giving us hope, giving us life. We want to thank Pastor Jeremy for coming. Thank for Serena taking the time out of their weekend and to be with us. I just pray for everybody here that God, you would work powerfully in their lives to help them to build up the body, as we just heard, by speaking the truth in love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.